Welcome to NATV YouTube podcast, right here on NATV Network. All right, you're going to enjoy this one. I had so much fun being with Coach Deb, transformational coach straight out of Colorado. You're going to enjoy this one. She covers everything from determination, motivation, and a whole lot more. She even goes down her personal journey of dealing with grief. And she inspires all. She talks about gratitude. So put your headphones on. You're going to enjoy this. Had so much fun, but now it's your turn to enjoy this conversation. It's a two-part conversation. If you want to see it all uncut and unedited, become a member to the channel. All right. Enough of me. More of my guests. NATV YouTube podcast. NATV Network.
I want to achieve at this very moment is to tell people this. You have a page that is inspirational, motivational, and you also have this really cool knack of being extremely funny and goofy at the same time.
Can you read my cup?
Oh, wait. Okay, that's cool. You need a pair of, you need some shirts like that and some pair of socks that you sell like that and put it on your page. Just, you should be doing. I'm looking forward to trying to talk to you as much as I can, but not taking your entire weekend. So I want to start with, of course, your IG page. Can you tell everybody how to find you, your IG page?
Yes, I'm. It's short for Colorado, so it's COLO Life Coach Deb.
So here we go. Let's start the show this way. Debbie, can you please, when you hear the word determination, tell everybody across social media from your own heart, what does that conjure up for you, determination, that word?
Consistency, being willing to get through anything, to just move forward, to keep yourself moving in the right direction. That's what determination means to me.
What are some things that can get in the way of a person trying to move in the right direction that you've experienced, especially when you try to help and coach people?
Oh, life in general, feeling unworthy, imposter syndrome, grief. So many things can get in your way. Again, life in general, just allowing things to come into your world that allow you to have excuses. If that makes sense.
No, never looked at it that way. So allowing things to come into your world, cross your path, as it were, so that you can have excuses to not be motivated, maybe, to not achieve.
To not be motivated, to not move forward, to not go after your dreams. And I think when we allow things to come into our world, it's because maybe we don't really understand how our why is working or how important those things are to us. I did want to say hi. My sister is on here. So I wanted to say hi.
Which one is she?
Lynn.
Okay. Lynn's in the house. Okay.
Yes. She's Lynn's my rock. She's my... She's been through everything with me, and she's my foundation and my rock and my solid soul.
There you go. Yeah. Solid soul. And that's your sister. Your sister's your solid soul. Mm-hmm. She's S3.
Okay. Yes.
Not everybody has a Lynn.
No.
But what they need to maybe find a Lynn in their life, as Lynn is giving you some love back on the screen.
Yeah. I just want to smile when I see her name. I think everybody needs somebody that gives them a safe place, that grounds them in times of chaos. We have been through a lot of death in our life together. And she was really my rock when my mom was sick. I lost my mom when I was 18, and she was my rock, and she was the first person I called after my husband passed away, and I just love her very, very much. And we're adopted. We're not actually biological sisters.
Yeah.
So, interesting fact.
For 672 hours in a month, and I asked people to come on my show and give me 2 hours, and they have no idea. It's not scripted. 2 hours out of their life, out of the whole month, I try to ask them that you walk into something knowing that it's not scripted and it's about you. And that's what these shows are about. So more about you and less about me. So that's the word determination. But I'm looking at your bio. And again, this is what the bio says. Debbie, you're a transformation coach. And it puts on here, you have written for social media to see if you lack motivation, determination, gratitude, and purpose, I am your secret weapon. Now, from your perspective, and for what you've been able to do working with other people, what you've received even from Lynn, what gets in the way of people's motivation?
Ooh, good question. I would say fear. A lot of times gets in people's way of motivation, and really taking that first step. If people will, I was just having this conversation yesterday with my friend from high school. A lot of things, I believe that people don't think they're worthy of change. They're afraid of change. And if they will just take that first step, usually 2, 3, 4, 5 come right after, and it's so easy to do. But I think that it's just fear. It's hard to be motivated when you're scared and you don't know. And I also think lack of knowledge. People always want to start different journeys and they don't know how. So instead of learning how, they just don't do it because it's too hard.
You brought up a good point there. So I want to travel down that road a little bit with you, because you bring up a valid point about knowledge. So let's, for someone that's listening, they don't have a knowledge, they don't have knowledge of something that they maybe want to do. Mm-hmm. Just as a transformation coach, as a life coach, as it were, give some type of step maybe that you can pass on, even if it's just two, that they can keep in mind to get the ball rolling.
Truthfully, Google and YouTube. Awesome. I know that sounds stupid, but
You said Google, and I was about, the next thing popped in my head was YouTube, and you said it. No, Google and YouTube, you're absolutely correct. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So, I mean, I guess I put it to this simplicity. My career is also in automotive. I've been in automotive since I was 16. I did not know how to jumpstart a car. And guess what? When my car died, and my daughter and I were trying to figure out how to jumpstart the car without having to pay a tow truck to come and pay all this money, what did we do? We YouTubed it and we learned how to jumpstart a car. You can start there. I don't necessarily think that it is the end all be all, because there's a lot of things like coaching that you can start with. You know, I don't want to sit on the couch anymore. I want to do these things. While you're not doing those things, take a little bit more research, but you can at least start and say, okay, what can I do for a hobby? What do I really want to do? A coach will take you much deeper into that than just, I think, a video can. And you just really connect and talking through things with people really changes the perspective.
What can kind of feed the beast and keep them going?
I think setting goals.
Okay.
I believe very highly in goals. And I think that every single person has different goals and reasons for them. Absolutely. I have absolutely different reasons of why I became a coach than other people do, right? My grief journey is what brought me into coaching. And I learned a lot about helping myself through that journey. So I think step one, do a little bit of research. Step two, start working on what your passions are, what drives you, what goals you want. sometimes those goals are dictated by life, right? We may have a health scare that all of a sudden life dictates that our goal is to take care of our health and to change our diet and to start exercising. But I think when you have to really figure out, because there's a lot of people that have chronic diseases that, you know, diabetes is one of those, right? Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. How many diabetics do we know that really don't eat the way that they should? So absolutely. They're not mm-hmm. motivated. They haven't had a scare large enough to get them motivated. And until they know what their why is, they're not going to work any harder than they did before.
What are some things that they need to do?
I absolutely believe that if you have something that either is continually coming up in your life or is a health risk that you really aren't doing anything about, it could, right. you know, another example would be drug abuse or alcoholism.
Absolutely.
You need to seek help. You mm-hmm. need to seek somebody that has training to help you understand why you're not motivated. Again, diabetes is one of these, heart condition, whatever. I mean, health risks especially are ones that are right in front of our face, right? If you have a health risk or somebody that has had a DUI and has another DUI and has another DUI, right. You obviously aren't going to do this on your own. You need help. You can do all the research you want, but you're not getting into why you can't change that habit and can't change that lifestyle. So you need to get help. And there's all types of help. I think Paxton is one of the big things. I believe coaching is where you are today and you want to go forward. I mm-hmm. believe counseling really helps you figure out how you got to this point and can also help you move forward. And I think in today's world, we need to stop being scared to ask for help. And asking for help is brave. And so many times we feel that asking for help is a weakness. And I think especially in men, I've found as I've gone along, I really started my coaching journey to work with widows and females mm-hmm. because I really felt like they were stuck. And my business now is 70% men. Yeah. And I think men really have a hard time asking for help because they're usually the problem solvers. Because mm-hmm. we just need to help you move forward. And help you realize that you don't have to stay stuck. I would tell you it's the core value of my entire life, which was introduced to me by my sister, who I hope is still on. Mm-hmm. But it's gratitude. Mm-hmm. And I know it sounds so simplistic, but when I got to my darkest place in my grief journey, mm-hmm. it was practicing daily gratitude that helped pull me out, helped make me realize that life has value in every single day, good days and bad days. And it is the driving force of my life today and will be for the rest of my life. And I know it sounds really simple, but it's not, because when you're, and again, I'm using my grief journey mm-hmm. as an example, mm-hmm. When you're missing your soulmate and you're missing the person that you woke up to every day and you're missing their smell and their touch and your soul just hurts, it is really a difficult time to be grateful because you don't want to. There's a point in your grief journey where you just want to be sad. You just don't want to be happy and you don't want life to move forward because you want mm-hmm. life to be, you know, when they were still here and you want to go backwards. And mm-hmm. that's not what life is. There's just a process where you have to say one day, okay, I'm left here and I'm going to make the best of it. And I'm going to start that journey today. And that's what I did when I hit my rock bottom. And that's what mm-hmm. I want to try to help people not have to hit rock bottom before they start implementing gratitude in their life. Because if you have a really solid gratitude journey or gratitude practice, of course you're going to grieve whoever you lose, but you mm-hmm. will grieve. I fully believe you will grieve differently.
But I have to ask you about hitting rock bottom because, again, we're trying to at least help one person may hear this, and they have no idea how to get out of that dark tunnel. You hit rock bottom what year? I just say the year. What year was that?
2014.
Okay, 2014. Mm-hmm. Now, your husband, your partner, you both were team players for life. He died when?
2013. March 1st, 2013.
March 1st, 2014. 2015.
13.
Excuse me.
Yeah. It was about a year and a half after he passed away that I hit my rock bottom.
Okay. Someone is dealing with what you've already passed through. What words of advice do you give them?
Okay. What I would say is to, when people say, what can I do for you? I'm here to help. How can I help you? Those are the people that you need to call on mm-hmm. when everybody stops calling. And you need to not, because what happens is everybody's there for you in the beginning, right?
Absolutely.
And
correct.
Everybody wants to help you. And then life goes on and their lives go on. Mm-hmm. Even if they were very, very close to that person, their lives go on as they should. Right.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's when your life starts to stand still even more so mm-hmm. because everybody goes home. Everybody stops calling. Everybody's not bringing food over anymore. Mm-hmm. You need at that point to call people, to ask for help, to not be by yourself 24/7, to not go digging into that.
To not be by yourself.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Don't retreat into a hole. Don't go into that cave where you say, you know what? They don't want to be around me. They don't want to be around me right now. I'm just sad. Who would want to be around me right now? They don't even know what to say. They don't know, they might not know what to say, but they can still be there for you. They can mm-hmm. still be a warm body. And after everybody kept going forward and I kept trying to show this person that was strong and, you know, right, I was being right. this role model for everybody.
Right. Yeah.
That's when things got really dark and I stopped reaching out to the true good people in my life and the people that had my best interest at heart. And I started going into a direction of people that were takers and abusers and not at the standard of level that I would normally hold myself accountable to. Right.
Right.
And that's what I think even pulled me lower into a deeper, darker grief. And right. what I say is start holding on to those people that are positive. And even though it might not be comfortable for you at that time, mm-hmm. hold on to those people and remember that there are other things in this world than that you can put your mind and your attention to than just your grief.
It's going to be a challenge. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No.
Yeah. Absolutely. It has to be intentional.
Mm-hmm.
It has to be intentional, and I really, on top of gratitude, getting a really strong gratitude practice in during grief, I also believe that you should try something new, or try something that you loved to do when you were young. Because this is a time in your life where you need to know it's okay to be you and to continue forward. So I personally believe that now is the time, even though you're sad, maybe you join that book club, or maybe you learn how to rock climb, or maybe you go out and buy a bicycle again and do something that is very specific for you and for you to have a positive element in your life that you didn't necessarily do with your, I mean, I'm talking about a widow grief right now or a widower grief.
No, right.
So do something that you didn't necessarily do with your partner. I by no means am saying that that grief will be easy. We're talking about small baby steps to get you going into the life that you want. And I highly, highly recommend when somebody goes through a loss that they get grief counseling right away. Yes. I really, hospice centers have this. There's so much counseling out there. And nowadays, you can actually do counseling over the phone. And I highly, highly believe that what I found when I became a widow, and this is just me, is I really found like I was trying to be strong for everybody else. So when it was time to talk to somebody, I felt like I couldn't be 100% honest. I couldn't really, my sister and I can ugly cry with my, we call it ugly cry. I can ugly cry with my sister, right? But I didn't really do that with a whole lot of people. Again, I think that when people say, I'm just a phone call away, how can I help? I want to help you. Take those people up. And you have to reach out to them. And you know what? The funny thing is, I think when you start grieving, you start feeling like a burden on people, right? And I believe that we're not a burden, right? We're just processing through our grief. So for me personally, I wish I would have reached out to my friends more. And instead, I got some new friends that didn't necessarily know all of my journey. And then I didn't have to talk about it. And then I just started asking it because I was hanging out with people that didn't know my husband. And I didn't have to talk. And it wasn't, how are you doing? Are you doing okay? And they didn't ask me those questions.
They didn't care.
No, because they, and I didn't share with them all. They knew I was a widow, but I didn't talk about it. And by not talking about it, it made it worse, right? Because then I would go home to this empty house and I wasn't dealing, I did not deal with my grief until I hit rock bottom, which was about a year and a half after Roy passed. Yeah, and they thought they knew me. They knew the Debbie I showed them.
Yeah.
They didn't know the real me. And
they got surface Debbie. They didn't get the Debbie that we see right now, a woman of substance.
Yeah, and you know what? I didn't even know that Debbie.
Of course not.
And when I look back, I don't dislike that Debbie. I think that Debbie had to play her role in my life to help me learn. I don't like to say I have regrets, but I definitely am not that woman today. But that woman got me to who I am today, and I'm okay with that. And that's why I'll share that story, because I think the more I can put it out there that it's okay to be broken when you lose somebody that you love so much, it's just not okay to stay broken. But it's okay to be broken. And then you have to start putting that new skin on, right? And you have to start letting that wound heal. And you have to start taking steps to move forward. And you have to know that life is meant to go on. And the way you honor that person is to be the absolutely best person and give to this world in the absolutely best way that you can and honor that person. Mm-hmm. And it was their life that impacted you so much that if you love somebody a lot, you should grieve. You should have deep grief, right? Because mm-hmm. they're gone and that's sad, but you right. don't have to stay there. And you need to move forward. I like to say that I'm not actively grieving. Again, it'll mm-hmm. be 8 years on March 1st. Okay. And March 1st sucks. I don't know how else to put it. It doesn't matter if there's somebody in my life, if they're not in my life. Nope. It is yep. a day that I will always mourn. And
oh, yeah.
that doesn't mean that whoever's in my life today or whatever, that I don't mm-hmm. love them or care for them. It's just that day is a day that brings me sadness. And yeah. at the same time, it also brings me joy because having my husband die in my arms was a gift. And I look at it that way, just like his birthday was a gift and our anniversary was a gift. And I celebrate those days, but they're conflicted. They bring me happiness and sadness at the same time. But I can process them now and live through them with gratitude.
I am so happy that we are able to begin a discussion about this off of this public service platform. But I'm not done. I'm far from done. And again, whenever you're ready to tap out and go like, hey, Paxton, I got more important things to do than talk to you. It's okay. But we're going to need to take a commercial break because I'm up against the clock here. And I want to go down this road more about gratitude and some other things that we're going to touch on. And then at the end of all of this, believe it or not, I've got a little game session that I'm going to do with you in which it's about your life. Or I want to say it's like that show, This Is Your Life, you know, that kind of thing. We're gonna talk about Debbie all day until she's ready to go. But the next segment is going to be more about gratitude and some other thing, everybody.
Which I don't even know about.
That is the most important point is, you know, I see all the other shows. I understand what everybody's doing, being prepared. I get that. But look at what we just got in 40, 50 minutes that you've passed on that I can turn this way and it's hitting the spot. Okay. It's hitting the spot for other people. I only want to help one person. I'm sitting there looking at seven people right now and one of them's crying. So just telling me teared up. So in the majority of them are guys. So we're doing what we need to do. Even if nobody else joins us, we're helping the people that are quietly watching. Thank you so much for that first segment. We're going to get into the second segment in a moment. And then Debbie will eventually be moving her way toward the end of the show in which we get to play Stump Debbie kind of a little thing.
Great.
Yes, okay. I just gave you the name. I wasn't going to give it, but here we go. It's going to be a Stump Debbie thing. And we will see. It will be related to your life with a little twist. I'm going to do something with you that I haven't done with other people, a little twist to it. So we will see what happens when we get to that point. So I'm glad you're not nervous. You did really well. You were awesome.
And
the cat was fluffy and good and everything was good. I'll see everybody in just a moment. I'll torture Debbie in a little bit and all of you can get to watch it. See you in a second.
All right.
Thanks, Debbie.
Bye.
I knew you would enjoy that one. We're going to have more of Coach Deb back again with the second episode coming your way. Looking forward to you joining us again. Please, we ask you to follow and support our guests. You will find all the information you need in the description for this video to reach out to Coach Deb. Book an appointment with her if you'd like. Contact her. That would be a great thing to do. We truly appreciate your support. Tap the subscribe button if you like our content. And by all means, let YouTube know you want more of our shows. Hit the super thanks button to donate to our podcast shows and our channel to keep us running at high level. We appreciate all that you've done for us up to this point, but right now, time for me to go. NATV YouTube podcast right here on NATV Network.